How's it going, everybody? This is Gil Swenson with Q4 Lacrosse. Welcome to 5 Questions for a Coach. We'll be asking college coaches some key questions on how players, prospects, and coaches can make the most out of their time during the current COVID-19 crisis. Today, we're joined by assistant men's lacrosse coach at St. Joseph's University, Mike Horowitz. Thanks for joining us today, Mike. How's it going, man?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Thanks for coming. So how you been doing with this whole thing?
It's tough living in Philadelphia. I don't have much of a backyard to run around on. Thankfully, I've got the stationary bike on the third floor and trying to stay busy as best I can, trying to stay in touch with our players and, trying to kind of fill out the day with, ways to make our coaching staff and our team better in whatever way we can.
Absolutely. So those of you guys that don't know, Mike started his career playing at Randolph High School in New Jersey, went on to be a starting goalie at Muhlenberg College in Allentown, PA, two-time All-Conference out there. And he started his coaching career at Fairleigh Dickinson, coached at Pfeiffer after that, and has been at St. Joe's for the last 6 years, as well as coaching with the Israel U19 and senior team for the last 5 years. So, all right, Mike, you ready to go?
Let's go.
All right, let's dive right in. So one question we're getting a lot is in regards to the 2021 specifically, and obviously can relate to the 2022s, even though they have a little bit more time in the process. But a lot of these guys really count on the spring season to, show to college coaches their progress, where they've been since the fall, since they last see them play. So what would you tell these uncommitted 21s and 22s about the recruiting process at this point? What should they be doing right now? How should they approach the remainder of the process with potentially losing their 2020 spring season?
Yeah, I think it's definitely uncharted waters for these guys right now who were expecting to kind of get one last crack to showcase themselves in front of college coaches. I think that, you just have to kind of control the controllable. So if anyone was lucky enough to scrimmage or anyone was lucky enough to play any kind of winter ball and, create some kind of highlights for coaches to get a look at, I think that would be great. Staying engaged with the coaches that you have been recruited by in the past is important. Whether or not, a coach is going to, be in a position to make any kind of decisions at this point is kind of a case by case basis, but it surely can only help you if your name is at the front of a coach's mind. So you have to kind of control the controllable. What you can control is staying in contact with the coaches that you have been in contact with up to this point. If you have any new footage that you feel like can benefit you in the recruiting process, if you can put that together, you should definitely be doing that. And just making sure that you're prepared for whenever we can kind of move on from this crisis. Really controlling the controllable means being ready to go when the bell rings and we're allowed to get back out on the field. If you're just spending your days sitting on the couch and watching TV, someone else is out there working and he's going to be ready for that, maybe one opportunity that he gets to play in front of college coaches that can kind of change the landscape for that young man's recruiting and potentially kind of put you to the side in other coaches' minds. So at the end of the day, you have to control what you can control and make sure that you're ready to take the next steps whenever you have the opportunity to do so.
Awesome. Yeah, I love that. So number two, what's the best advice you can give all players at home right now, not just prospects, what they can be doing at home, maybe with limited equipment, limited space, to continue improving their game?
Yes. Yeah, so the first thing I say is there's always a way. Winners will never make an excuse for themselves. So, if I was a player right now who doesn't really have a wall to throw against, doesn't really have a backyard to run around, I'll grab the chalk out of the basement. I'll draw 50 yards on the street and I'll run 50 yard shuttles. I'll work on my footwork. I will figure out a way to put myself in a position to succeed. The more you can do, the better. So if you're lucky enough to have a weight room, if you're lucky enough to be able to go for a run in your neighborhood safely, you're lucky enough to have a wall, whatever you can do to get a leg up on that guy who is sitting on the couch, the better chance you'll have, again, when your numbers call to showcase yourself. I think you can always figure out a way to get a sweat in. You can always find a way to get on a wall somewhere. And if you're lucky enough to have a goal at your disposal and a bucket of balls, you should be doing that on a daily basis. What I've been telling all of our guys as we kind of periodically call and check in, our players are using this as an opportunity to get a leg up on the other teams in our league and our opponents, because you can control the fact right now that you can work harder than the average college lacrosse player. And in turn, you can work harder than the average high school lacrosse player. You can distance yourself right now if you choose. So, trying to find a silver lining in all this madness, I think that's what we're trying to preach to our guys. Use this as an opportunity to gain an edge on the people who just show up to practice for 2 hours and don't think about lacrosse the rest of the day.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think you mentioned it before we started the interview about, just throwing shoes down, using extra shoes, using anything you got at home. Some people might think you need cones, you need ladders, you need all this stuff just to do basic footwork or agilities. But just throw whatever you got down, right?
And just absolutely. Winners always find a way.
Love it. Love that quote. All right, number three, moving on towards more coaching side. So for the coaches out there, what are you telling your players right now? How are you handling your team here, especially from like a high school or youth coach point of view? If the season does get the chance to resume, if we get to play, shortened season, whatever it is, how are you handling your team at this point? What are you telling them? How are you keeping them kind of engaged and ready to go?
Yeah, so at St. Joe's, we're doing weekly meetings with our guys, just checking in, making sure that everyone's engaged, kind of keeping them up to date on what's going on. Obviously, right now, things are still very much in flux in terms of when these guys are going to have an opportunity to play again. The eligibility things are starting to get ironed out by the NCAA. But, beyond that, we're trying to keep as a coaching staff our players mentally engaged in the game. So, we're lucky enough to have some great film editing software that we can share clips with our team. And obviously, everything is voluntary for our guys. So, making sure that you have leadership on your roster who's able to push guys to kind of do extra is obviously very important. But we've been creating small, five-question question-answer film clips for our guys, and if they choose to answer those questions and stay engaged, just maybe things that we would have shown in film over the course of the week, ways that we can improve. We've been doing that on a weekly basis. We're planning on scouting our opponents going forward and kind of taking the mental reps and showing the guys, how we would defend or how we would attack teams going forward in our league. So again, just trying to find a way to keep our guys mentally sharp. And then it's really up to the guys to hold each other accountable for being physically sharp. Because obviously at this point, everything is voluntary for those guys.
For sure. It's awesome. So the other one here that we've been getting a lot is specifically from the 2020 commits. So obviously with the NCAA voting to grant spring athletes an additional year of eligibility, what are you telling 2020 commits about next season with potentially some seniors returning for a fifth year? Is it going to cause a logjam of talent, larger rosters? What are you telling those guys?
Well, there are a couple things. The large roster is what it is. At the end of the day, the best players will play. This year we had a lot of freshmen on our roster see significant minutes and impact every game this season. So just because there are more guys on the roster doesn't mean that these underclassmen won't have a chance to improve over the course of kind of this lockdown and over the course of this coming fall, God willing. It's something that every school is going to have to deal with. The freshmen are just going to have to treat it as such and put themselves in a position to compete once they get to school. It's difficult always for a freshman to make that jump, especially when it comes to Division I athletics, to make that jump from playing against 16, 17-year-olds to 21, 22, and how you might have some 23, 24-year-olds on college rosters this coming year. So whatever you can do, again, to kind of start putting on the weight, to start working on your footwork, shooting if you can, it's critical, because you're going to have to do the extra work on your own that will put you in a position to succeed as a freshman. It is kind of what it is at this point, and you need to make the best decisions for you. I know that some high school players might consider postgraduate opportunities in prep school. I think that's just kind of on a case-by-case basis. There are positives and negatives to every decision that you make, and it's a case-by-case basis. But I think that that a lot of rosters are skewing larger in college anyway. And it will be no different this year as it will in subsequent years. So, those freshmen can kind of do whatever is in their power to get better, just like everybody else will. And I guarantee you that the ones who work hard will see improvement and will be ready to go at a higher clip than those who don't when we get back to action in the fall.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, best players will play, right? It's never
challenged.
All right. So last fifth and final here, position specific question. Obviously, with you being a goalie and spend a lot of time coaching the goalies, what can goalies be doing at home right now with limited equipment or space, potentially nobody to shoot on them, anything they can be doing?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's a lot that can be done as a goaltender as long as you compete in these drills, even if you don't have a shooter. We have a series of drills at St. Joe's. We call them dad drills because, dad can do it. Your sister could do it. All things that don't require a high level shooter. So catching the ball with your bare hand is critical. And again, you don't have a goal. Pace out 6 feet. Drop a glove where the pipe might be. And figure out a way to simulate that goal, figure out a way for you to see the ball moving into your hand. I think it's important that you try to find ways to track the ball from your dad or your brother's hand into your own and keep that muscle memory going. Most people won't be able to stand in a cage and stare down shots. And if you're not one of those lucky ones who can, you can still find a way by just getting the ball tossed to you in a variety of ways. So we kind of work from the ground up. So the progression that we'll go through is first, our goalies will be on both knees. Their feet will be on goal line extended. And we'll throw five balls to each area of the goal, the imaginary goal. So we're talking stick side high, off stick high. We're actually going over the head as well. Some of the things that gets overlooked when coaching goalies is training these guys to make saves directly over their head. Stick side hip, off stick hip, stick side low, off stick low, and in the five hole. Then we'll put our goaltenders on one knee. And your knee that's down will be on the opposite side of where the ball gets tossed. So if my left knee is down, the ball will be thrown off my right ear. And that kind of isolates that drive foot to drive yourself off that single knee up into the top corners to really work on pushing across the ball. And then from there, we'll stand back up. We'll put one foot on a pipe with our heels parallel to the goal line and working on really getting outside the ball, tossing the ball from pipe to pipe, kind of up and down the pipe. So you definitely have a progression that you can work in 5 to 10 minutes easily that can really put you in a position to be successful once you can really put the chest pad on and see real shots. So like I said in the beginning, if there's a will, there's a way, and the winners will definitely find a way, especially in the goal.
Awesome. That's a ton of good stuff right there. All right. Bonus question. People looking for stuff to do at home, what's your favorite sports book to read and your favorite sports movie to watch?
Yeah. So my favorite sports book. So people who have coached with me for long enough know that I'm actually a huge soccer fan. I just feel like European soccer has just the most athletic talent on the whole of any sport in the world. You've got five major leagues. You have great coaches. And the guy that is probably the most influential coach and player really in all of European soccer is Johan Cruyff. He's a Dutch offensive midfielder, striker, played for Barcelona, played for Ajax in Amsterdam, and a Dutch national team player. And it's actually in my Instagram bio. One of my favorite quotes is from Johan Cruyff. It says that in his teams, his goalkeeper is the first attacker and his striker is the first defender. And he kind of talks about how he changed really the Barcelona Academy. So anyone who knows much about soccer knows that the Barcelona has become the standard for youth development in soccer. The way that they play, training their players play a certain way from the time they enter their academy to hopefully joining their senior team. So the book is called My Turn by Johan Cruyff. He's known for a trick move that he broke out in the World Cup in the 70s called the Cruyff Turn. So the book is an autobiography by Johan Cruyff called My Turn. Love that book. In terms of movies, you throw a sports movie in front of me, I'll watch it. I know that when I was probably some of your guys at Montgomery's age, I had not seen Hoosiers yet. And I remember going to Blockbuster, if any of the high school guys know what Blockbuster is at this point. And my dad basically forcing Hoosiers upon me. And, the first couple minutes go by, I'm like, Dad, what are we watching? But obviously became captivated by it. And I would say Hoosiers is one, especially for the young guys, if they've never seen it, to pop that in with dad or on your own. And watch Hoosiers. Great underdog basketball story.
I have actually never seen Hoosiers, so I'm going to add that to my list. Quarantine movies, man.
Definitely.
Wow. All right. Well, good stuff, man. I appreciate you coming on and kicking things off here.
Thanks for having me. Everybody stay safe and stay healthy. Stay home.
All right, man. Hawk will never die.
All right.